like to have sex and then marry the man she defrauded. Degenerate fraud, all the phony people, where do they all come from? All the phony people, what do they all see done? Poor Robert Blakey got caught in money, these haters' paternity scheme. Went to the extreme, took her to dinner, left her in the car and went back for the gun he forgot. Said Bonnie was shot, all the phony people, where do they all come from? All the phony people, why do they all seem dumb? But she finally got all the fame she did see. In time for sweet, sweet, poor Robert Blakey hasn't had ratings like this since way back in the day. Another OJ, all the phony people, where do they all come from? All the phony people, it's truly tedious.
Imagine all the instruments you...
I can't ever do that. If they don't know, if they don't recognize, you got to just shut up.
You just have to take it.
You just have to take it. What did you say to him?
I said, listen, I'm
on my way to work.
Yeah.
I'm only a couple of blocks away. I took off the seatbelt. I was wearing it on the parkway. I took it off because I'm only a couple of blocks away.
No, he knew right away. He knew you were lying.
Well, I'm sure he did. He said, well, what do you work? I said, I work at FAN. I'm about to go on Don Imus' show.
Yeah.
I said, so maybe you could do the right thing and, you know.
I'll be a Stern fan. That's
well,
my first thing.
Well, he may have been because he didn't. He just kept writing the ticket.
First of all, don't be giving cops any lip anyway. Just shut up and take the ticket.
I mean,
and wear your seatbelt.
$85.
That's tough.
That's a lot of money for a ticket, don't you think?
No, if a cop pulls you over, just say, yes, sir, hand me a license and move on. Don't be fat-mouthing cops.
I didn't bad-mouth the cop. All I said was...
Don't say anything.
Just say yes, sir.
Yes. Say yes, sir. Thank you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
May I have another?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, officer.
Thank you for reminding me. I'll try to do better in the future.
Yes, sir.
Enjoy your coffee.
Imus in the morning. 2020 sports with Sid, Osama bin Rosenberg.
Good morning, son.
Hello, Iman. Big night last night in the NBA playoffs. The New Jersey Nets. You thought they may wrap it up last night in Indiana against the Pacers? That would not be the case. The Nets blown out in Indiana last night, lost by 23 points.
Suck.
Well, they are the number one seed in the Eastern Conference.
How are they doing?
They're tied 2-2.
Yeah, game five with an 8 seed.
It's true. And that'll be in New Jersey tomorrow night.
Pathetic.
Also last night in the NBA playoffs,
What is the deal with that? Who's the guy with the socks, the black socks?
Is that Keith Van Horn you're talking about?
Jesus, God.
It is a bad look.
And by the way, does he get up and look at that hair and think, hey, this looks pretty good. I'll go with this.
I think I'll go.
Yeah. Hey, I got an idea. Why don't I go on TV with this hair? And these socks like this. The guy's retarded.
Well, he's not a good-looking guy. I'll give you that. Well, you know, he went to in school out in Utah, you know, with the Mormons.
Well, whatever he did.
Yeah. Well, I guess that's acceptable behavior out there. Outside of Park City, of course. I guess in Salt Lake City, that's okay.
I guess.
Well, he's not the best-looking guy in the NBA, I'll give you that. But don't you remember when Rick Smits used to be the center for the Pacers? He used to wear his socks real high, Iron Man, up above his knees?
No, I don't.
No? How high do you wear your socks when you go to the gym on a daily basis?
Down around my ankles.
You push them down, right?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, because you don't want to... I mean, it affects the circulation in your legs. That's the first thing. Too tight.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
I just thought it looked stupid. Yeah.
No, it does look stupid. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Right on both counts.
You go out and you buy those ankle socks, those tennis socks.
I wear my wife's socks, actually.
Really?
Yeah. Well, you know.
We have something in common. You wear your wife's socks, I wear my wife's underwear.
We know that. We found that out yesterday, but let's not move on here. What else? How'd the Islanders do?
Islanders lost. Islanders went down 4-2, and they lose the series in 7 games now.
Good.
So I thought Lou would be more depressed today. I was actually...
Oh, he's not in a good mood.
It really is because of the Islanders, you think?
Well, he hasn't said anything. He's got a bunch of yucks. He has said nothing this morning.
He's got nothing, yeah.
Which is fine. I mean, he's entitled to be depressed.
And you know that if the Islanders won last night, I mean, if you're walking in with this new New York Islanders t-shirt that he bought last week, like the decals are still sticky. It's such a new shirt.
Yeah.
You're supposed to take that shirt and rub it in the street for a couple of minutes. It looks like it's game worn. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Unless it's not your shirt, right?
Well, Sid doesn't have any shirts that are his shirts. What else? Come on.
Also tonight, Boston and Philadelphia, a series that
could be a great game.
It should be a great game. All three games have been very good games, and the home team, of course, has won every game up to this point.
So this is in Boston tonight?
In Philadelphia.
What is in Philadelphia?
First two in Boston, I-Man. Next two in Boston, in Philadelphia, I should say. If the 76ers win tonight, they will return to Boston for a game 5.
What do you think will happen?
I think the Celtics wrap it up tonight. What do you think is going to happen?
It depends on how Iverson plays.
Let's say Iverson plays good.
Then the Sixers win.
Yeah, that's what I was going
to
say.
Then they go back to Boston, and Boston wins there.
Yeah, that's probably the way it's going to go down.
No.
That's a good job.
We need Boston. I mean, I'm not patronizing Boston.
No.
We need Boston to be the kind of franchise it used to be.
What, are you talking about the days of Larry Bird and Kevin McHale, or back to the days of Bill Russell when they won, you know, 10 championships?
I wouldn't mind that either.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we need them. You know, those used to be great. I'm not a Boston Celtics fan, by the way.
You're a Lakers fan.
Yeah. But I just like to see it. There's something about it.
They were
parquet floor, because they tore up.
Yeah.
The institution of the Boston Celtics.
Yeah, the dynasty.
Do you miss the old days of...
I like the fans in Boston because they're loyal.
They're loyal, of course.
I like
great
that
fans.
About them.
Do you miss the old days of the great teams in the NBA when the Sixers were great, the Lakers are great, the Celtics are great?
No,
they were great with Bill Buckner. They're loyal. They were great. Excellent fans. Hooray for them.
What was that Islander score again?
The guy had to move out of Boston.
What was the Islander score again?
Well, I don't... 4-2 Toronto.
Get fast, people.
Hooray,
Boston.
I'm a city morning. Imagine all the instruments you hear playing.
The Neverly Grand Resort and Country Club, just an hour from Manhattan, wants to invite you and your family to enjoy discounted summer rates through Labor Day weekend, where kids stay free. Not only is there day-long activities for the parents, but kids will love day camp with lots of fun activities. Play 4-star rated 27-hole championship golf course designed by Robert Trent Jones and Tom Fazio. Packages start at $199 per room per night and include deluxe accommodations, gourmet meals, live music and dancing, a cocktail party on Saturday evening, and use of the indoor pool and state-of-the-art fitness center. Enjoy horseback riding, nature walks, and an invigorating massage. Go to Neverly Grand today, 800-647-6000, or visit them at www.neverly.com. That's 800-647-6000. The Neverly Grand, just a whisper away.
Your glasses just aren't helping your eyes. I know that sounds harsh, but you probably know that from your own experience. Corrective lenses don't cure poor eyesight. In fact, our doctors believe they can...
Let me finish. Now, I know MSNBC simulcast, and I'm well aware of that. And so we're talking to you and 12 or 15 million other people on the radio, and suddenly you're reading something from the television screen.
What are you thinking about?
I'm thinking about the stinking shows on television also.
Yes, but
that's what I'm thinking about.
But,
I mean, to try to act like it's not on television is stupid.
Yes,
it's on television, stupid.
I understand that, but we don't do it as a television show.
No, it's a radio program.
That's all we care about is the radio.
Stupid.
I've been offered...
You have a TV show. You're on television.
Your radio sounds fun, Martin. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Our radio program is simulcast.
What the hell is that on my television set?
It's our radio program.
I want you to take your left hand and put it on your left ear.
Yeah.
And your right hand and put it on your right ear.
Right.
And pull your head out of your butt.
Sleek. At Volvo, we think it's the only...
Think she did against... Al Sharpton, so.
Okay.
But he's a little wrapped up in himself. They all are over there, but they have to go through Chris to get to the White House. I mean, it's just so preposterous that it's laughable.
They have to come through here.
Sort of like ripping off Tim Russert's thing.
But the implication is, if they don't appear with Chris, they're not going to be able to be elected president.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Yep.
Yep. I mean, it's just absurd.
Yep.
And he made no headway with Reverend Al. I mean, it was ridiculous. Because Reverend Al wouldn't let him.
And had it. At one point he said, well, why say disingenuous? Don't you mean dishonest?
He said, well, no, don't put words in my mouth.
He said, I'm talking.
Yeah. Like, you're listening, Chris.
Yeah. Well, Matthew said Hillary on, they did everything but hold hands.
Yeah, so. I mean, all of these Democrats, they're not going to get hammered by Chris Matthews. It's just not going to happen. So.
Well, Reverend Al didn't.
No, I mean, it was laughable.
Whipple ball.
So. Chris's book, Beyond Our Grandest Notions, which I thought was a great book.
Yep.
Just his idea. I thought he should have spent more time on it, but, you know, he's in a hurry, so. But, whatever. Tonight, he's going to do something with the Jessica Lynch deal and with the Smirk Boy, a big countdown. I don't know what he's going to do. And then on the Abrams with plugs, something about the Scott deal and that hideous-looking woman that Amber Fry he was having an affair with, who was grotesque-looking.
And here was this
his wife was cute.
Just this little doll, Lacey. Yeah. It was just good.
And then with Scarborough, I don't know what he's doing. It's something with the illegal immigrants, of which he should be one.
And he may be.
And he may, in fact, be from another planet. Well, that's what's coming up. But it's worth watching. Have you watched MSNBC, Sid?
I watch it sometimes. I was at the Palm last night having some steak dinner, so I wasn't able to watch it last night. But
the news babes are, I think that's
good looking. Yeah.
A lot better than if you're going to watch the news. I mean, why not watch it with the hot news babes?
I'm a big fan of Natalie Morales. I think she's gorgeous.
She is.
Christy Musumeci is a good-looking girl.
Yeah, they got some of the little blonde babes. Pretty awesome.
Yeah.
New meat there.
New meat?
Yeah. I may even show up for the Christmas party next year.
So I live in Manhattan.
You're not invited.
And I happen to live right across the street from where the Tavern on the Green where the marathon ends.
Yeah.
On Central Park West. So you can't. If you're out of town, which I sometimes am, often am on the weekends, if you try to get back to your apartment, the police won't let you until after 9 o'clock at night.
Good Lord.
Now, is that by foot or by car? Can you get there by foot if you wanted to?
Yes.
All right, so there is a way. You just can't have the limo drive you directly in front of the building.
Well, what do you do with all the stuff you have?
You get Brad to slog it over. What else do you do? You walk to your house, chill out, and have Brandt, give a couple of his boys. Good eye, man.
Bring it up the rear, haul him to
stuff? No, but you see, the problem is usually Wyatt's asleep, so he weighs 60 pounds.
Yeah.
I'm not going to carry him from Columbus to Central Park West.
Throw him over your shoulders. You've been working out. Be an experience.
Put him in the stroller.
Come on.
Here's what's going to happen.
Fuck it up.
I'll be at 68th and in Columbus Avenue around 7:30 Sunday night, and I'm going through. So.
And now what?
See? Now, so.
There you go.
The fat traffic cop. I'll explain to the fat traffic cop why I'm going through.
Yeah.
Going through. And now what?
Fat traffic cop.
Here's the reason. I'm going through because I'm coming through. Now what?
Chernoff will be bailing you out the next morning at Midtown North.
A couple of months ago, it was, don't give any back talk to cops. Now he's barreling through.
Well, I wouldn't give any back talk to a regular cop.
Now he's going through blockade.
These are not regular cops. These are not regular police officers.
Oh, sure they are. They're pulled off regular duty to attend to this stupid marathon. Absolutely they are.
Sure, and they're working traffic.
They're told to put on uniforms.
That's
detectives
it.
And everybody. They come back in to do this.
Traffic detail.
Let me tell you, Fatso, I'm getting rid of my apartment.
They're regular police officers with guns and stuff?
Not only.
Of course.
They're even higher up.
That's different. I thought they were like these traffic morons and they stand out here with a whistle and they're not those, huh?
Just go ahead. Listen here, Fatso. I'm going
that's
through.
Okay.
What are you going to do about it?
Those are crossing guards talking about.
Yeah, those are traffic enforcement agents
different.
That you're disparaging.
Yeah.
They're there for to perform a duty.
They're there during rush hour.
Yeah, they're there during the tough times.
Dangerous jobs. Sometimes they get wiped out by cars out of control. Yeah.
They're not going to be these are regular cops. I'll have to win,
sure.
Oh, come on.
Bus race.
I'll have a conversation with them about it.
Wave you your
could.
Gun.
You could have a discussion.
Wave your gun.
Gun fight. That's a good idea.
Hey, does this give you anywhere?
No, don't just wave your gun. You know, pop off a couple
of
shots.
Hey, look, I got one like you.
What did I just tell you, Lord? Ask it out of the way.
I'm coming through.
Oh, yeah, that's what I'm going
to
do.
I'm still trying to hit that can down there. How about that, officer?
Hey, 27 after the hour.
But I could hit, never mind.
Let me hear, one of these great American hero deals, will you?
Boy.
I don't care.
I'll shoot you.
28 after the hour. Yeah, idiot.
What kind of bullets you got in that thing, bro?
I got these steel deals. Oh, no, I can't show you that.
J.D. Hayworth?
Can I get through now?
Howard Feynman and Mike Stanley.
Imus in the Morning presents Real American Losers.
Real American Losers.
Salute you, Mr. Nationally Syndicated Conservative Radio Talk Show Host.
Mr. Nationally Syndicated Conservative Radio Talk Show Host!
Without your righteous moral indignation, we might find ourselves unable to know what we're supposed to think.
Make me feel smart now!
Wildly pontificating upon every subject of which you are the consummate experts, which you think is just about everything.
I am not worthy!
Politics, pop culture, athletic endeavors, there's nothing you don't have a pompous opinion about to force down the throats of your listening audience with sneering condescension. And no one's pain or misfortune is beyond your condemnation or exploitation, except when it's your own.
Anybody got a Xanax?
So here's to you, loser. We salute your human frailty and want you to know that as we speak, Al Franken's already writing his next book. And when this one's published, you'll need to take pills. But at least this time, you'll actually qualify for a prescription.
Mr. Nationally Syndicated Conservative Radio Talk Show!
I was in the Morning.
Why do people say that? Now, you know, people say you enjoy the rest of your day.
Yeah.
Shut up.
I miss in the Morning.
God, that's annoying.
I miss in the Morning.
Imagine all the instruments you hear playing are actually pictures created by...
Son, I'm Adrian Watson with the ExxonMobil Fan Highway Patrol.
I'm Miss in the Morning 2024 rolls on.
Good morning, this is John Minko, and this report brought to you by Grey Goose, the world's best-tasting vodka. The Olympic update in the closing seconds. The United States leads Spain 70-55 in women's basketball. Earlier today, the United States beating Chinese Taipei 3-0. Women's water polo, U.S. 8, Russia 4. Swimming finals in the women's 200 backstroke, 800 freestyle, and the men's 100 butterfly, the 50-meter freestyle today. And Gail Devers advances to the second round of the women's 100-meter dash. But what a game between the Yankees and the Twins last night in the Metrodome. The Yankees led 9-3, but seven unanswered Minnesota runs gave the Twins a one-run lead in the ninth inning with their closer.
Hey.
No.
When I ran in the store as a surprise, and I got this huge, huge, you know, big, big box for 10 kids, you know.
Well, I had foster play.
And what did you do? You yelled at me.
Let me say what happened. I'm sitting in a Jeep listening to Bill Parcells being interviewed after the Jets game.
Yes. So loud, by the way.
Wait a minute.
That God forbid it happened to be in the store.
Wait a minute.
You know, and I'm in one of those mini-marts.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
I'm parked. People, you know,
wait a minute. Wait a minute.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Right. And then what happened when we were decorating the Christmas tree? You blame me for the lights being all twisted up and started screaming at me about that.
Because you did.
I'm an idiot and I
can't. No, I've never called you an idiot.
Well, honey, I'll talk to you later.
Oh,
you are an idiot.
You're so funny.
Imus in the Morning.
At BMW base.
Hesitant about me.
Play your extras instead.
Today, we salute you, Mr. Long-Suffering Boston Red Sox fan.
Mr. Long-Suffering Boston Red Sox fan!
You possess a childlike faith in and heartbreakingly eternal loyalty to a team that perennially comes up short.
Maybe next year.
Eyes steadfastly on the prize. You vainly attempt to disregard the fact that you're cursed by a New York baseball legend.
Damn that Bambino!
Through thick and thin, you stick with your team as they draw deceptively close to the spoils of the ultimate victory. looking as pathetic as a mental patient staring open-mouthed at a light bulb, refusing to admit the painful truth that it just ain't ever gonna happen.
I wanna kill myself!
So crack open a nice cold case of beers and start drinking, loser. Because the only way to subdue the relentlessly maddening pain of inveterate defeats is to get sh-faced.
Mr. Long-suffering Boston Red Sox fan!
Well, we are in Portland, Maine, at the Merrill Auditorium. With primarily, I suspect, a Republican audience.
About half the audience is gone. They all went to work, so you would imagine the rest there.
Well, I was going to point out that half the audience is gone because it's almost near 9 o'clock because they have jobs. So. Please welcome now. Sid's going to do sports in a second, but first, please welcome to the Imus of the Morning program, making a trip up with us from New York. Bishop Egan. Okay. Good morning, Bishop Egan.
Good morning, Card Blast. Good to be here with you, heathen bastards in Portland, Maine, be Jesus. Especially sweet to be here in Lobster Land with the nation's number one crab. You buy this view and schmuck, you be Jesus.
That'll be fine.
However, forget McCord. Let me compliment the I-Man on his new hairdo. I-Man actually had blonde highlights put in his hair, if you can believe that. You talk about putting lipstick on a pig, be Jesus, I tell you that. Like Sonny Von Bulow getting her toenails painted, be Jesus. Flipping waste of good money, silly old bag of bones, you. Well, I'm Mr. Mard. Yeah. You've no doubt heard about that poor wee little black girl who went to her school in New York City with a picture of a gorilla on a folder, only to have the teacher ask her if the gorilla was a member of her family, be Jesus. Poor girl was very upset. Bloody outrage, I, Mr. Marr.
Yeah.
But whatever you do, I, man, just make sure you don't send poor little Wyatt, I, Mr. School, with his Jurassic Park lunch pal, be Jesus, some bad thing. Or I'll never be the same. Let me wish a happy Halloween to one and all, I, Mr. Marr.
Yeah.
Like a broken clock comes in handy twice a day, that ridiculous wardrobe and ghoulish face of yours actually comes in handy one day a year, be Jesus. Today's that day. Huckleberry Hound meets the mummy.
Shut up, you people.
And the big question, I, Mr. Mard.
Yeah.
Will Hillary run? Let me just say this. I hope Hillary does run. Hope she runs right in front of a speeding bus, be Jesus. Along with you and your Jesus-hating Hebrew homo bagel-eating sportcaster, God forgive me. The rest of you dirtbags, be Jesus. Let us pray.
Okay.
Let us pray.
All right.
In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, it's greedy, selfish celebrities we hate the most. Rosie O'Donnell's a bitch who eats all that she sees. Let there be no doubt, she stands up when she pees.
Oh, God.
Kobe Bryant's a hero for raping white hoes. He gets standing O's for, well, getting standing O's. Jesus. Oprah and Katie, shameless ratings whores. To hose either one, past the Viagra endures. Let's pray that when Larry King takes his nap, his wife's having butt sex with Warren Sapp.
Oh, Jesus. Shut up. Good God.
P. Diddy's a slave master. P. Diddy's a slave master. The marathon he'll run. Let's hope Shook Knight's there, armed with a gun. And why are queers taking over TV, you ask? It seems we must watch with rubber gloves and a mask. And that whiny Don Imus, he bitches and moans. When McCord up and stabs him, I'll masturbate to his groans, be Jesus, God forgive me. Amen, go and love and serve the Lord. Which is the belonging way?
This is my favorite part because, one, it's near the end,
right,
and it's often amusing. Which says the belonging way?
Which is the belonging way? A, hip-hop mogul Sean P. Diddy Combs.
Hip-hop mogul Sean Combs.
B, New York City Mayor Mike Bloomberg.
Okay.
C, radio legend Imus in the Morning. Which is the belonging way?
Well, clearly, a radio legend Imus in the Morning.
Wrong, you brain-dead old lizard, you be Jesus. While all three attention-starved, unpopular New Yorkers have become filthy rich in spite of their clearly limited mental capacities, Imus in the Morning.
Yeah.
The answer is B, Mike Bloomberg doesn't belong because, unlike the other two, yeah, Mayor Barfag hasn't been compared to Kathy Lee Gifford in the past week, be Jesus, slobbered old scumbag. Yeah. Have a lovely weekend, the whole lot of you, be Jesus.
Mr. Began here on the Imus Morning program.
I fought the law. You look different.
I had the diet.
I believe I'm talking to you again. I mean, you're the best. I want to be just like you. Well, I walk down the street and I yell at everybody. I say, hey, you're fat and stupid. You're not getting it done. Get out. Just because I want to be just like you, you're my idol. I was there at the museum yesterday. Did you see me? I was the one in the cowboy hat and the boots and the really, really tight jeans because I want to be just like you. I think some people thought I was you because I even signed a few autographs. I signed Get Out, Don Imus. And a couple of the people were disappointed because they thought I was Gene Autry and not you, but I don't care. I pretended I was you, and I went outside to the hot dog man and I ate 5 hot dogs. And then I told the hot dog man he couldn't suck enough.
If your radio light really sucks in the morning, said, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
And he said he was going to call the cops, and I said, I'm the I-Man. Google the tube. And then the cops came, and I said I was you, and I showed them pictures I took of the rocks in the park where I live, and they gave me your address, and so I'm going to go over there now and pretend I'm you and go upstairs and wait for you to come home. Deirdre and I'll be waiting for you, I-Man, so don't be late.
I'm in the morning.
Terrorism from Imus in Washington. Among the latest developments, the Bush administration is expressing concern over the stunning advances of Afghanistan's Northern Alliance freedom fighters and has issued an urgent request that they not occupy Davenport, Iowa, which was reached by a Northern Alliance expeditionary force about an hour ago. The Alliance's interior minister has just given a battlefield assessment, and America Goes ballistic microphones were there.
This is too easy. First Mazar-e-Sharif, then Kabul, Kandahar, went through Pakistan and India like they were full of, well, Pakistanis and Indians, for crying out loud. Australia, please. Europe didn't even have a clue. I mean, Tony Blair, a tea-sucking bedwetter. And so here we are. Stick 'em up.
In liberated Kabul, as the draconian regime of the Taliban was swept away, jubilation, with men shaving their beards, throwing their turbans in the trash, and replacing the soulful call to morning prayer with a degree of desperation is seen in the Bush administration's nation-building efforts for post-war Afghanistan in the appointment of former Red Cross director Bernadine Healy to head up an interim provisional government in Kabul. At the White House, Press Secretary Ari Fleischer announced the Healy appointment.
Well, we didn't just want to totally abandon the people over there like we did last time out. And as you know, Bernadine aggravated the hell out of everybody who had to deal with her here. So we thought, let them hate her over there for a while.
More today on the struggle for the hearts and minds of the Islamic world as American strategists try to devise ways of countering the Western hatred that is taught in Pakistan's strict Islamic madrasa schools. A sampling from a madrasa classroom tape smuggled to America Goes Ballistic correspondents.
Students, what is answer to 2 + 2?
America must die.
Who discovered America?
Satan.
Who is American president?
Bush.
Who is next president of America?
Osama.
And that is because you will be what when you grow up?
Crapdusters.
Meanwhile, Homeland Security Chief Tom Ridge said today that following a comprehensive review involving the FBI, the FAA, and the National Transportation Safety Board, the best, quickest way of restoring the public's confidence in air travel appears to be requiring airliners to use America's vast interstate highway system. Governor Ridge briefed reporters on the concept a short time ago.
Well, actually, when I got to thinking about this, I thought, hey, why are we making this so damn difficult? The principal problem with aircraft is, of course, altitude. No altitude, no problem. Now, I've investigated this thoroughly. We've got a highway network in this great land that goes, well, heck, everywhere. So this is our proposal, and here's our new airline travel slogan. Don't ground the planes. Keep the planes on the ground.
At the Justice Department, Attorney General John Ashcroft was said to be unavailable for comment on the Ridge proposal as he was busy inserting electrodes into the molars of a Saudi Arabian exchange student. And finally, hi everybody, Pat O'Brien here. After the Bush administration approached Hollywood about how the entertainment industry might join the nation's war on terrorism, word that some studios are investigating ways to help. Columbia is exploring a sequel to its Marine Corps courtroom drama, A Few Good Men, starring Jack Nicholson and Tom Cruise. The new film, tentatively titled A Few Bad Germs, goes inside the Centers for Disease Control for an expose of CDC capability to deal with a bioterrorist attack. Here's a clip.
You want anthrax?
I think I'm entitled to it.
You want anthrax?
I want the flu!
You can't handle the flu!
There's a for sale sign on the big old rusty tractor.
Tax, tags, and registration includes 10,000 miles a year, 20 cents for each mile over, 5224, do it in...
During the sweet, tender eyes of a paint horse named Cimarron, I found a kinder, gentler me. But it wasn't easy. The first few nights of detox had me naked on a mesa, howling at the moon in a vain attempt to find a few peyote buttons to take the edge off. At first, I abhorred being forced to engage in lengthy, twice-daily group therapy sessions among those who, in my other life, I lived to loathe. The bleeding heart, entitlement loving, weepy wussy liberals, and mustache sporting lesbian feminazis who. Sorry, when I diminish others, I only diminish myself. In group, I was initially, as I was on the outside, an intolerant, ignorant boor. Your last film went direct to video, so you'd take 12 Vicodin and then call it a night? Why didn't you just take 50 Vicodin and a bottle of vodka and call it a life? But now, incredibly, I actually find myself uttering the phrase, I feel your pain. And meaning it. Friends, my initial plan was to spend 28 days learning the 12 steps just so I wouldn't have to spend 3 to 5 years behind bars. Keep a low profile and hope that the courtesy afforded me during my valiant attempt to overcome my addiction would take the heat off me long enough until another celebrity could bear the brunt of media scrutiny. But thanks to my higher power, Bill Wilson, and the 7 other damaged souls who sit alongside me each day in our circle of healing, I once was lost, but now I'm found. And so I offer my sympathies and support to Matt Lauer, who, it appears, had a little problem with nose candy back in the 80s. And although he's kicked his addiction, I would suggest there be a full investigation of all those Today Show folks. An intervention, if you will. Because Al Roker's lost an awful lot of weight, sounding suspiciously to me like the effects of a Bolivian toot diet. And Katie Couric, I think there may be a much more insidious reason behind that incessant vivaciousness. No one's that perky in the morning without a little help, if you know what I mean.
I don't know if this is a just bizarre story. Please welcome to the Imus in the Morning program the father of Sidney Rosenberg, Harvey Rosenberg. Good morning, Mr. Rosenberg.
Yes, good morning, Iman. How are you?
Fine, baby. How you doing?
I'm doing great.
How's Mom?
The Mom is fine. The whole family is great. We're looking forward to speaking with you this morning.
Okay. How do you think your son is doing?
I think he's doing very well, thank you. And I thank you for your great leadership in his career.
Did you, Come on, Harv. Harv, come on. Your son's already in a tank for me. I mean, you don't have to do anything. Harvey, come back. Did you see the fight your son was involved in?
I don't want to go there.
Well, your son displayed great courage. He didn't quit.
Let me tell you something.
No.
He didn't back down.
He acquitted himself well in the courage department. He did.
No, that's very, very true. That's very true.
A lot of heart.
Of course, he got
a lot of heart, a lot of soul,
a lot of blood.
Of course, he got his ass whipped. Got the hell beat out of him.
But he is a good kid.
All right, Mr. Rosenberg, your son had a story yesterday on this program. Charles, you better explain.
Well, I don't. I forget the particular affiliation. Was it a family member,
a
relative,
a physician that they know? Apparently, Harvey knows him.
Well, anyway, that an obstetrician, I assume, was somebody associated with the Rosenberg family in one way or another. During a delivery procedure, I believe, after the child was born, closed the woman's orifice that had nothing to do with the birth of the child.
Right.
And we find that alarming and, in fact, actually incredible that this could have happened.
Do you know about this story, Harvey?
I don't know how, knowing Sid, that anybody can say anything is incredible, actually.
Yeah. But is it?
It's the true story.
Oh, it is?
Oh, sure.
How can it possibly be a true story?
What is your connection to this physician?
Actually, there are a number of physicians that have done this already, by the way. I know of at least two.
That have sewn up, instead of sewing up the vagina, sewed up the other deal.
Sewed up the other orifice that lies merely in... South of it by a matter of a few centimeters.
Yeah.
How is that possible?
Exactly. It's very possible, I understand. I've discussed this with other, physicians, and they tell me that it happens all the time, so...
That can't possibly be the case, Harvey. How could that happen?
It just makes you very angry when you eat those two cheeseburgers you were talking about.
Shut up. I don't mean to be disrespectful, but come on here.
I mean, you know that this has happened.
Yes, I do. I know of two different physicians that have done this, but I cannot tell you anything. I took the Hippocratic Oath.
Oh, are they still practicing?
They were practicing.
All right, everything else all right with him?
Everything else is great. I thank you for the call. I really do. And have a great day.
All right, Harvey. Thanks. Harvey Rosenberg, the father of Sid Rosenberg, here on the Amish Wine program. In effect, substantiating Sid's assertion that this physician actually... sewed up this woman.
Actually, knows two physicians that have done this.
Right.
That have sewed up the...
His father went right in the tank for me, too, didn't he?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They'd make a sandwich out of you if they went over to the house. Oh,
it is, that's just...
Yeah, but, it is Sid's dad.
Yeah, you're right.
It's like the Hilton sisters' parents,
You're right. Good point.
We need an independent source.
We'd have to hear from him.
I don't think... I mean, your father, I have... I have enormous respect for your father, and he is your father and all that, but I just think...
Seems like a lovely man.
But I just think we need some independent cooperation.
Oh, absolutely.
We need a medical authority to say, yes, this has happened.
When you say you have enormous respect for my father, is that possible? That's a slight exaggeration?
Well, no, because he's your father, and he sounds like he's not a dope. And
no, not at all.
No. Dope. Let me tell you something about my father. He is a chemical engineer, which is just a couple of feet away from a nuclear physicist. He's a genius, to be quite frank.
We could talk with... Well, Dr. Richard Matthey wouldn't do it. He's just not going to...
He wouldn't get
on the radio. He just won't.
No.
Dr. McKenzie probably wouldn't either.
No.
What about the ring doctor?
Yeah, Bronson. He in the heartbeat. He won't. Bronson's a...
He's probably done that.
Bronson?
Yeah.
No,
he's an
orthopedist.
He's an orthopedic surgeon.
Not an obstetrician.
They do these surveys in New York about who's the best doctors in New York, and Bronson's always the best orthopedic surgeon, the best in the country. But yeah, he probably has done something like that.
When they get home, who knows what they do.
A Saturday night.
Zipper mask and get the knee.
He operated on me when he put a plate in my shoulder when I got bucked off that horse.
Yeah, that's what he told you.
Check your butt.
Everything's fine, hon.
Because he put it in the wrong shoulder, but that's fine. No, he didn't. No, he's...
Well, you constipated back then.
Oh, come on.
Track called it attractive.